Let me just say that for a second here, we're going to act as if we're having a great big business meeting. We won't say anything important. Let me go down to business. No, I don't need to be sacrilegious. As I said, the last words at the Last Supper were, if you want to get in the picture, you've got to miss
Thank you very much.
That's a pretty polite way of kicking them on. Well, I'm pleased to be able to be here and thank you for your support of Republican principles and ideals. Because of your efforts, perhaps you know this already, support by the Hispanic American community increased from 28% in the 1980 election to 48% in the 1984. I think the Hispanic American community has always understood the importance of family and tradition as values in our country. And our party has continued to hold the door open for Hispanic Americans who want to feel that their sense of patriotism and concern over our country's future is appreciated. Consistent with your commitment to the future of our country is our commitment to economic opportunity and growth and fairness. Our fair share tax plan is designed to give everyone the economic opportunity we feel they deserve. It makes the system fairer. It makes the tax rates lower. The top personal rate will drop from 50% to 35%. The corporations from 46% to 33%, and the top capital gains tax will be only 17.5%. The objective, particularly of that latter, is to create a small business renaissance here in our country. Three, with regard to the family in our plan, we are providing long overdue relief by increasing the standard deduction and practically doubling the personal exemption to $2,000 for each dependent. We think it's time the government stopped punishing families and started giving them a hand. And we want, with the tax reduction of 81 and the tax plan of 85, to reactivate the economy and improve the quality of life for all Americans. And already, based on that 81 tax cut, there have been results. Unemployment is now 6.9%, and that's the lowest it's been in 5 years. And we had the most broad-based reduction in poverty we've had in over the last 10 years. And I'm pleased to note that the gain among the Hispanics in that same period, the median income for a family has increased in real dollars by 6.8%. And for the rest of Americans, the non-minority section of Americans, that increase has only been 3.3%. Our economy has produced 8 million new jobs since November of 1982, and many of those have gone to Hispanic Americans, I'm sure you know. And at last, I want to thank you for your efforts on behalf of our freedom fighters in Nicaragua. I'm going to need your continued efforts for behalf of freedom and opportunity for Central America. We must continue to communicate to the Congress how our adversaries in Central America are serious and our commitment to our principles must never waver. And on all these vital topics, we must continue to speak out. Never underestimate the good that you as concerned citizens can do for our entire nation. Well, now that's enough for me as a monologue, and we can, should have a little dialogue here.
Mr. President, on behalf of the leadership of the Republican National Hispanic Assembly and the board that's assembled here, both the state chairpersons as well as the national board members, elected board members, we want to thank you for your generous invitation to spend these moments with you and to exchange our thoughts with you. There are three areas that we would like to briefly mention to you. One is the entire area of Hispanic business participation in government programs. The other is the area of tax reform, which we have supported you consistently from the day you announced your tax reform initiative. The other is our continuing support for your policies in Central America, your support of the freedom fighters in Nicaragua, and our continuing commitment to you to ensure that that support is there for those people who are trying to free themselves from enslavement of the Marxist Sandinista government. I would like to call on a couple of our people here. Before I do, I do want to mention a couple of people who have done enormous work for you on your behalf in the past. I hate to single out people, but it's important that I do in this case. Gotera Fonseca, Garcia Fonseca from New York, has been most active in your behalf, as has everyone around this room. But the other individual is Rafael Franchi, who heads up the state organization in Virginia next door and has done a marvelous job for you in the past. He's directly behind you here. Now I would, if I may, Mr. President, just call on Steve Denlinger, who has been involved in the quest for opportunities for Hispanic business over the years, and a couple of friends of yours who are here, who have been here in cabinet room sessions before, who are examples and are exemplary persons in the business world.
Good morning, Mr. President. It's a very distinct pleasure to be here. We'll get right to the point since your time is short. We would like to talk to you a little bit this morning about the underrepresentation of Hispanic businesses in federal contracting. It is a pattern which is pervasive throughout the federal government, and we think it needs your attention. Before we go into that, though, I'd like to express our collective gratitude for your strong support of minority business over the past 5 years of your administration. Through those programs, we have a number of successes with us here today. Mr. Fernando Nieva from Infotech, Mr. George Adams from Mobility Systems, and John Mariano from WebTech in South Bronx, who you know for his good work over there. John started out 10 years ago with sales of less than $100,000 and 5 people working in one of the worst parts of the United States, Florida Passion. He's now a $100 million a year company traded on the American Stock Exchange and one of the outstanding examples of what we're trying to be all about, Mr. President, in the field of minority business. Unfortunately, there are still some obstacles. We still find that even today, Mr. President, some high-level officials and countless bureaucrats in the federal government still resist your minority business policies. We continue to encounter agencies recently, the Treasury and the Army, for example, which are unresponsive, sometimes even hostile to our country. Another obstacle is the long-standing pattern of underrepresentation of Hispanics in federal contracting. Of the $15 billion that SBA awarded over the past 10 years to minority firms, 70% went to black-owned companies and less than 20% went to Hispanic firms. The shortfall to the Hispanic community, Mr. President, over this decade is about $3 billion. This equates to thousands of contracts foregone and thousands of jobs foregone by the Hispanic community. This represents $3 billion worth of economic development which did not take place in the Hispanic community over the past 10 years. Virtually every federal agency refuses to acknowledge the underrepresentation of Hispanics in their contracting program. Mr. De Baca has some figures there which very, very briefly encapsulate the story. The pencil ones, right? Mr. President, we We cannot overcome these obstacles without your help. We feel we need cabinet-level meetings, sanctioned by yourself, to review the status of Hispanic participation in the procurement programs of the executive agencies. Under the leadership of Mr. Ibaka and other capable RNHA officials, these meetings will be designed to sensitize secretaries and their top-level staffs to the minority enterprise policies of your administration, to sensitize them to the underrepresentation of Hispanics in the federal contracting programs, and sensitize them to the need to seek out qualified Hispanics for key jobs in their small business and procurement department. Mr. President, we are not asking for any new costly programs or for the creation of a new bureaucracy. We are simply asking for your moral leadership. We request that you designate your Chief of Staff, Mr. Don Regan, to oversee this RNHA initiative. Thank you, Mr. President, for your time and consideration on a subject that is extremely important to the Hispanic community.
Well, thank you. And yes, I have thought that we were moving very well in the idea of trying to, with regard to government contracts and so forth, bring in minority efforts and minority business and so forth. And what you've just told me, that evidently is falling short where you're concerned, and I do want to know about that. And it just occurred to me that, Linda, if you could, here and there, if you've got some specific cases or something as examples, get them directly to Linda, and I mean directly to me, and we will take this up with the cabinet, because some of the facts and figures just generally on minority efforts, I thought we were doing pretty well. We don't want anyone standing on the sidelines.
Overall, we are doing very well. Continues to be that obfuscation on the part of the departments not wanting to look at the difference in the percentage of the ratio. The ratio has only started to change, Mr. President, since Jim Sanders realized the nature of the problem a couple of years ago, but it is still pervasive.
Thank you. All right. And when you mentioned bureaucracy, I remember John Kennedy once saying that he would issue an executive order of some kind and out it would go. And then he said he kept trying to find out where did it just seep into the sands and disappear all the time in bureaucracy. So I know that can happen.
Mr. President, I would be remiss if I didn't call on George Adams, who is the one of our two national co-chairmen. George lives in Los Angeles, has been very active in support of the freedom fighters in Nicaragua and supported your policy there. And I'd like you to just make a couple comments.
Mr. President, I'm from California. We're very happy that you're here, but we missed you there. And I remember I was here once before during a small business committee, which I used to be the chairman of the California delegation. And we mentioned about bureaucracy. I believe you say bureaucracy is the biggest big business that we have in this country. We are honored to be here with you today to convey our strong support for your efforts to halt the spread of communism. Some of us come from communist countries, as you probably understand. In Central America and throughout the world, the RNHA strongly supports your foreign policy initiative, particularly with respect to the support you have constantly advocated for the freedom fighters of Nicaragua. We too support the efforts of the people of Nicaragua to free themselves from the tyranny of the Marxist Sandinist regime. To demonstrate the strength of our belief, Mr. President, we are sponsoring, as part of our National Leadership Conference, a panel on Central America. We have held rallies to support your policies all over the country, especially in California, Florida, and other parts of the Texas and New York.
In New Jersey too, please.
New Jersey also. Thank you. We have held rallies to support your policy and plan to mount a vigorous grassroots campaign in support of your policies. Mr. President, please know that we support you and that we love you, Mr. President.
Well, thank you very much, and I'm glad to hear that, because the strides that have been made south of our border. Today, we can say that about 90% of the people in Latin America are living either in democracies or countries that are rapidly tending that way. But the one sore spot, and it isn't just localized, they have made it plain that there are no borders to their revolution, is Nicaragua. And it is the foothold on the mainland here, and we must not let them try it. When I was in Europe for the economic summit, that's how I found that many of them over there had an impression that, well, there might be a risk that Nicaragua and the Sandinista government was drifting toward communism, but they had no idea that it is a totalitarian communist state. You can't go much farther than putting Karl Marx and Lenin on your stamps. And that's the pictures that are on their postage stamps. So I'm glad to hear that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The mayor of Ponce, our other national co-chairman, Ponce, Puerto Rico, one of the largest cities, of course, in Puerto Rico, and a very active supporter of yours in the entire Caribbean basin.
Mr. President, it's a great pleasure for me to be here with all of us, together with you in this common effort. We're really proud as Hispanics for your stance regarding Central America. You have shown you have it. And we fully support your tax reform. We are a little bit skeptical about the results of Section 936 as to Puerto Rico. And we just want you to know that we would love to be the example for Latin America of the American way, of the American influence in Puerto Rico as a Latin American country, and you can count with all our support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. President, I'm a Cuban American from Maryland. And respectfully, I would like to ask you a question. Do you have in your agenda as a top priority the Cuban Nicaraguan situation when you talk to Mr. Gorbachev?
Very much so. Yes. That the nature of that talk has got to be based on that if we're to get along, and if both of us really want peace in the world, and we certainly do, we have to have more than words. We have to have some deeds to prove that they do mean that they want to get along with us. I'm going to try to make that very plain.
Mr. President, if I could ask you just to remain, we need to get a group photo. If I could ask the people on this side of the room just to
remain. I just wanted to mention that San Francisco, Vega, Michigan. And I wanted to mention that what you did last night is not a start for a president addressing the Hispanic citizens for 30 minutes. It was a fantastic program, President. And I hope it's only the first one. We need that very bad.
The man in the blue dress in the back, you move a little to your left. Great. Perfect. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You know, I know it's a good time for me to leave. But I just want to tell you something. Maybe I told some of you this before. 1966, running for governor in California, never thought I'd ever be doing such a thing. One of our schedules called for going over to East Los Angeles.
Yes.
And doing just a walk down the street, you know, on the street, and maybe ducking in some stores or something with people there. Well, Governor Brown, the incumbent, had found out about this. So by the time we arrived, it was quite a goodly crowd of Democrats with signs that made it evident they weren't for me. And there was a nice-looking little boy that, as I started, they just accompanied me. I was sort of the head of the troop, but it was mainly those brown people with their placards. And, of course, there were some of our own people with placards. Well, this little boy, he had a brown placard, and he was walking along right beside me there.
well, the jostling of the crowd and everything, every once in a while, he'd get almost knocked down and start to fall. And I'd reach and grab him by the arm and straighten him up, and on we'd go again. This happened about three or four times. And I don't know when the change occurred, but all of a sudden I looked over. He was carrying a Ronald Reagan sign. He was a handsome little boy, but it's hard for me to realize now he's a grown-up man. But I often wonder what became of him. I know things went well. Well, all right. Thank you all. Thank you.
Best person I hired.
Good seeing you.
Horsepower Russell moving back.